Hey, today we'll be looking into the lore of Diluc. We'll start off with his ancestry and go through his whole story up until the latest event. Hope you enjoy the video. Timestamps are below. Diluc's ancestry. Diluc is the master of the Dawn Winery and the last of the Ragnvinder family, one of the founding families of Mondstadt. The name Ragnvinder is thought to be derived from Old Norse and translates to something like wind god. The Ragnvinders were part of the aristocracy until 1,000 years ago, when one of them spoke with the Dawnlight swordswoman of the Wanderer's troop. She questioned his beliefs that the aristocrats were noble and why they should be placed on a pedestal above others, making him take notice of how the people suffered under them. When she was eventually killed in the gladiator's arena, he retrieved her sword and buried it as a sign of respect. He then took the name the Dawn Knight in her honor and joined Vanessa's rebellion to take down the aristocracy and bring freedom back to their people. Diluc seems to have other heroic figures in his ancestry, with the nameless red-haired knight that joined Venti in taking down Decarabian likely being the earliest we know of. Diluc's childhood. Diluc was a happy child and looked up to his father Crippus like a hero. He was friends with Jean, and both of them owned tortoises, though Diluc doesn't have his anymore as it kept wandering off. When a young Kaeya was left at the Dawn Winery, Diluc's father took him in and raised the two boys together. Though Diluc admired him, Crippus didn't feel like he was a hero, as he was unable to live up to his heroic lineage, not qualifying to join the Knights of Favonius or receiving a vision. This caused him to put his hopes into Diluc, pushing him to train rigorously and become the greatest of all the knights. Diluc obtained his vision at 10 years old, which only added to his father's insistence that he join the knights. It paid off, and Diluc became the youngest cavalry captain in their history at only 14 years old, with even Grandmaster Varka praising him as the pride of the knights. Back then, he was loved and praised by the people of Mondstadt. However, the praise he received from his father was what he valued the most. He had a good relationship with his adoptive brother Kaeya too, and it seemed his life was going perfectly until his 18th birthday, when his world was turned upside down. Crippus's death. While returning home from his birthday celebrations with his father, Ursa the Drake attacked their carriage. His father had bought a delusion from the black market a long time ago that he was considering gifting to Diluc, but knowing Diluc couldn't defeat Ursa, he used it himself to protect his son. It drove the dragon off, but backfired, and left Crippus in an agonizing, near-death state. Diluc was in shock at how quickly everything had just happened, but fulfilled what seemed to be his father's last request, to end his suffering. There is conflicting information about this, some sources saying that the delusion killed Crippus, and others saying that Diluc did. I think that both can be true in the sense that the delusion had fatally wounded him and he was dying slowly. So Diluc ended his suffering as a mercy. Going to the knight's headquarters, Diluc was told by Inspector Erok that the incident would be covered up and his father's sacrifice would not be acknowledged, due to him being a mere businessman. After this insult to his father's name, Diluc threw his vision and knight's coat down and resigned instantly, telling Erok not to dare forget that Mondstadt exists due to people like his father. This was all witnessed by a young Amber who was hiding in an office cabinet at the time. After this, Kaeya came to the Dawn Winery and told Diluc of his secrets, that he was meant to be a spy for Conria that would one day help to destroy Mondstadt. Due to just having lost his father, and now his adoptive brother telling him this, Diluc's fiery temper erupted, and the two brothers fought in a heated battle. This event caused Kaeya to receive his vision, but ironically scarred his covered eye, though didn't blind it. This day seems to have caused Diluc to avoid going out in public for a while. Kaeya would write letters telling him that Erok was under investigation from Varka's inner circle, but progress was slow. He also mentioned that he'd heard Diluc was planning to leave Mondstadt for a while, and advised him to go without Varka knowing, as he'd probably have wanted to persuade him to stay. It seems that Alice was the one to recommend Diluc go out and experience the world, writing a letter to him expressing her condolences for his father, and telling him that his kindness to Klee, after she'd made a mess of his vineyard, showed that he is a lot gentler than he appears. She also tells him, "Since you helped my child out, I hope you don't mind if I treat you as my own," which Diluc doesn't argue against. She tells him, "Go out and see the world, that's the best course of action I can envision. Only by feeling, observing, and listening can your heart be healed." Diluc would leave Mondstadt, but it seems that rather than relaxation being the goal, he chose to extract his revenge. Diluc's revenge. He decided if his title as a knight and his vision couldn't help him to protect his father, then they were useless. Trying to understand why they were attacked, he left Mondstadt to search for the truth. Eventually, he would discover that the Fatui were behind the attacks of Ursa the Drake, and they were also the creators of delusions. So he went on a rampage of revenge against the organization that were the cause of his father's death. Without a vision, but probably using his father's delusion, he took down many Fatui strongholds throughout Teyvat, like a raging fire. The Harbingers watched from the shadows until they felt they needed to intervene and took action against him themselves. Diluc only just escaped death due to a mysterious observer from the north who was part of a vast intelligence network. This network was most likely the same one Krautslied of the Wanderer's troop created 1,000 years ago to protect Mondstadt from the shadows, as Mondstadt is known to be in the north of Teyvat. Varka would send a letter to Diluc during his travels, telling him that his father defeating Ursa would be acknowledged, and that he had given Jean full authority to punish Erok for his actions. When Erok was fired from the Knights, Kaeya wrote a letter to Diluc to let him know that he'd be bringing a glass of wine to watch Erok pack his bags. Though not related by blood, with Krepus raising him as his son, and growing up with Diluc as a brother, I like to think that Kaeya sees them both as family more than his real father, who abandoned him. After Diluc took some time to reflect on his anger and other shortcomings, he decided to join the underground intelligence network, committing himself fully as he had during his time with the Knights, along with his talents, caused him to quickly rise through the ranks and become one of the leading members. In his time with the organization, he must have learned more about the Abyss Order, as Rostam was once a member and died fighting against the abyssal monsters that poured out of Khaenria hundreds of years ago. The Dark Knight Hero. He decided to go back home to the Dorm Winery 4 years after leaving, making him around 22 at the start of the game. Though this timeline gets a bit murky with the manga's placement. After returning home, he modified the ceremonial uniform his father had gifted to him, to instead use it in battle against the Abyss Order and anything else threatening Mondstadt. He became such a threat to them that they feared even the sight of his crimson-red outfit. Diluc's return surprisingly didn't cause much of a stir though, as the mysterious vigilante known as the Dark Knight Hero suddenly appeared and became the talk of the town, taking the spotlight away from Diluc. He would also work with Albedo to discover information about the ley lines and the Abyss Order, with Albedo speculating that certain beings within the Order would be able to manipulate the ley lines if they were powerful enough. when the Fatui arrived in Mondstadt to pressure the knights and the church to hand over their children as payment for protection, Diluc and Kaeya teamed up to make sure that they wouldn't get what they wanted. Though the two couldn't help but throw a few insults at each other, they seemed to be on much better terms than they did before Diluc left Mondstadt. Diluc used his identity as the Dark Knight Hero to interrogate Dottore's assistant in the cellar of the Dorm Winery, but Dottore appeared and killed the assistant himself, taunting Diluc, but deciding not to attack when he noticed the delusion he was using, possibly recognizing it from Diluc's time hunting the Fatui, or just having a general interest in someone he doesn't know using a delusion. After Kale's Archon Residue Serpent killed a group of Schneznayan diplomats, the Dark Knight Hero took the blame for attacking them, as his delusion's powers were quite similar. This helped the knights to deny any accusations the Fatui tried to pin on them for blackmail. When Dottore's next underling, Barnabas, who had done experiments on Kale, came to Mondstadt to pressure the knights, he discovered Kale's Archon Residue had been sealed away by Sino and transformed himself into a monster to kill Amber and Kale in revenge. Diluc saved them with his delusion and staged a fake fight against Kaeya, allowing himself to be caught and taken by the Fatui soldiers, fully clearing the knights of any suspicion. He easily escaped after they left town and sent his shattered delusion to Dottore as a message that he'll defeat the Fatui without it. After all this, Kaeya came to Angel's Share, where Diluc was working, and gifted him an ornate vase, not mentioning that it contained Diluc's vision, which Kaeya must have kept safe for him all this time. Diluc returned to using his vision and protecting Mondstadt as the Dark Knight Hero, preventing threats from the Abyss Order and anyone else, just like Rostam had in the past. Present day, even though he owns a winery and sometimes works at his tavern Angel's Share, he doesn't drink wine because of his work schedule. Keeping up appearances as the young master of the winery in the day, and then working all night as the Dark Knight Hero, doesn't allow for any downtime. He becomes involved with our Traveler's Quest with Venti and Jean, and helps to save Dvalin, as well as fending off an attack on Mondstadt from the Abyss Order, and taking down some Fatui plots. We then meet him at the Golden Apple Archipelago, as he received a letter about there being an Abyss Order stronghold on one of the islands. This was a trick by Alice to get him to go, but regardless of this, he still helps to discover what the mystery of the islands is. He and Kaeya seem to be getting along better, though they still bicker like siblings, with Kaeya blaming Diluc for melting his ice bridge, and Diluc blaming Kaeya for them being lost. Klee even invites Diluc to go catch fish with her, which might mean she no longer sees him as a weird grown-up, but probably shocks Diluc with her method of catching fish. After this, we become a bartender at his bar Angel's Share, and there are a few other events he appears briefly in, but nothing particularly big. And with his latest event, Hidden Strife, it's Diluc dealing with the ley lines, but it mostly focuses on different letters he has received and sent to others previously, like Alice, Kaeya, Jean, Varka, and Albedo, filling in a few blanks in Diluc's history. So that's Diluc's story for now. I think he's going to be an important character as the story gets darker, probably when Mondstadt is facing destruction from any number of threats out there. Hopefully neither he nor Kaeya will have to sacrifice themselves to save the other, or worse, fight on opposing sides of a war. If you've made it this far, thank you very much for watching. Consider leaving a like and subscribing if you like the video, and leave a comment if you have any thoughts to share. Good luck on your wishes, and I hope you have a great day.